St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. Rebuke him, O God, when we beseech thee, undo thou. O Prince, heaven a host by the divine power, drive into hell Satan and the other evil spirits who wander through the world, seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Most sacred heart of Jesus, have mercy on us. Amen. Say your name is Lisa.
Yes, that's right. Yes.
I have two names, Lisa. I'm getting a second name here. I'm not getting Lisa at all. You've been to Blackpool before, haven't you? I can see this. Yes?
Yes, well, a long time ago, I can...
Oh, 30-odd years
that's
ago.
That's right. Mm. I made a film here all that time ago.
Ah, this is why I can't understand why I'm getting these two images. I'm seeing this lady who's obviously very cultured, and I'm getting this industrial mill-type image.
Mm. Well,
was the film about that?
You're absolutely right. It was called Hindle Wakes, and I played a mill girl in it.
That's when I'm getting an industrial scene, like mills and machinery, and there seems to be quite a lot of machinery all around you.
Wakes go back many, many years, and they are peculiar to the textile industry. And towns closed in order for a week's holiday. They would just get the 1 week in summer and odd days, Christmas Day, Boxing Day, a day at Easter, and that would be about all. But it was odd that people who would work together all year, many of them picked the same place to go to on holiday, so of course when they met at Blackpool, they were just continuing their associations from work to the holiday period. The Saturday morning of the Wakes week, the railway station and its approaches would be absolutely packed with people waiting to go on holiday. Children with their buckets and spades, mums and dads looking harassed, packed with, loaded down with suitcases, just waiting for special train, one special train after another, to come in and take them to wherever it was. And by lunchtime, the centre of the towns would be absolutely deserted, almost like a ghost town.
Here we have vivid pictures of the biggest strike that mill country's ever known. No mules spinning and no looms weaving. And I did hear say there was no trams running neither. There's summit up with summit. I know what it is, I've just remembered. It's Wakes week. The entire population is basking and bathing at Blackpool. Here's a gradely do, plunging and swimming in pool. Who's having a good time, who is?
Bolton, Burnley, Nelson, Cone, Blackburn, Darwin, Horwich and Todmorden, Accrington, Blackburn, Chorley, Haslingden, Bacup, Rottenstall and Waterford. So that in that period of 6 or 7 weeks, virtually the whole of the textile industry in our part of the world closes down for its Wakes holiday fortnight.
Oh, before we arrived in Blackpool, there was more fun. Because, you see, as soon as we were passing Preston, the Blackpool Tower would come into view. Well, when they saw Blackpool Tower, well, if you was on the train, you'd pop your head out of the window and probably get a piece of dust from the train in your eye, but you didn't bother about that. And if you were on the coach, one half of the coach would be hanging at the other end. They think it was a real, real sight to see. They thought it was brilliant. Think it was the Eiffel Tower, never mind Blackpool Tower. We were so excited. We couldn't wait to get there. No, we couldn't. Blackpool Tower was a marvellous scene to us in those days.
16 million individual visits to Blackpool are made every year. The visitors spend a staggering £250 million. I'm told that's more money than the whole of Greece and the Greek islands take combined.
The resort has 180,000 holiday beds, which is more than the whole nation of Portugal. The revenue brought into the town through tourism is a massive £350 million, which is almost £1 million a day. There are 3,000 hotels, guest houses and self-catering units in the resort. There are 16 million annual visits made to Blackpool, and by 9 a.m. on a Sunday, some 500,000 eggs have been cracked with 2 million rashers of bacon. By midnight, two large herds of pigs will need to have been slaughtered to provide the bacon, sausages, pork pies that the tourists eat.
Here you are, my dears. One of my best rooms. Nice and light and airy. Hot and cold running water. Oh, out of the way, Alfred. Interior sprung mattresses. Every modern comfort, just like it says in the advertisements. And if you should want anything, just ring for Mr. Slaughter.
Thank you.
Come along, Alfred. Whee! Blackpool, here we come.
On an average day in Blackpool, 6,000 cups of tea are consumed in the Tower Ballroom, 18,649 people pay for deck chairs, and 60 tons of rubbish are removed. 46 people can miss their coach home, 40 acres of potatoes are dug up to convert into chips, 47.5 miles of hot dogs are consumed, 184 tons of food are used.
We have 36 discos and nightclubs in Blackpool. We have 3 ballrooms, 7 cinemas, and 8 live shows. So you can accommodate people, you can feed them, and you can entertain them.
Neon lights will be spelling Lisa. Another star is on the way. Me on the front cover of Picture Goer. Meet new star Lisa Danilely, 22-year-old brunette who plays the leading role in Hindle Wakes, soon to be seen on the London screen.
Shave. Then I put my sunshimmer on. Then I do my hair. Then I put all my makeup on and then I get dressed. It's a really good place. There's everything to do. You can go for a drink, you can go on the arcade, you can go play bingo,
Pleasure Beach.
Go on Pleasure Beach, Waxworks, go see the lights, anything. There's just plenty to do.
I've ride on a tram.
And if you want a quiet day, you can even go to Fleetwood.
Well, I work at Symbols Biscuits, being a biscuit packer.
I'm unemployed at the moment. Saturday's the main night, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's the main night of the week, and we talk about it all week. Oh, I can't wait till Saturday! And we get really excited, we do. So, and when we go out on a Saturday, it's, oh, we're out, we're screaming our heads up. Yeah, we like our Saturday night.
As early as 1876, we were putting advertisements in local papers in the mill towns advertising Blackpool. The fact is that we were the very first resort in the United Kingdom to levy a rate for advertising purposes. So in true terms, we invented advertising and holidays generally. By the turn of the century, of course, Blackpool had a very different image. It was a place where people would come to walk along the promenade, to enjoy sea bathing, and it was quite salubrious. It was a very, very nice place indeed to come. And it wasn't until the early 1900s that the entrepreneurs decided that really we ought to go down market and become a little bit razzmatazz. So it became the resort for the common man, where Blackpool was offering one simple ingredient. It was called fun. As the holiday industry only commenced and finished when the cotton towns came on holiday, and then all the visitors went away. So What happened was that you got entrepreneurs with large theatres in the winter period and they didn't know what to do with them. So as long ago as 1898, the Blackpool's very first conference commenced, and it started in the Grand Theatre. It's the Royal Society of Health. And in fact, I like to think we almost invented conferences, and it was purely by accident because the entrepreneurs didn't know what to do with the theatres, so they filled them with conference delegates. And instead of being entertained, they started to entertain themselves by talking. It's almost ridiculous when you think that the Empress Ballroom started off as a palace for the common working man to dance in, and now it's been hailed as Mrs. Thatcher's, Mr. Kinnock's favourite conference centre.
Stalin was our ally against Hitler when Russia was invaded. But when Hitler had been destroyed, Stalin made himself our principal object of dread.
That's why it seems to me that if we are to safeguard employment in Great Britain, we have to be resolute about it and clear about it and say we can only safeguard employment for British workers by socialist planning in Great Britain
and socialist planning in other parts. Proving our loyalty to these high causes is the proper role for a people with few national assets.
So as we go from here, carry the fight back into the country. Let us proclaim this theme of unity, comradeship, and loyalty, which has animated all our debates this week.
This government of principle is seeking the common consent of the people of Britain to work together for the prosperity that has eluded us for so long. There are those who say our nation...
Well, the Winter Garden, of course, is, I still think, quite the best hall to address a very large number of people. It's old-fashioned, so the acoustics are a bit tricky, but you can actually use them. It's not like a modern conference centre, which all too often deadens everything you say. You know, if you drop your voice, the system raises the volume, and if you raise your voice, it drops it again, so it can be very flattening. You can actually get almost an echo out of the Winter Garden, and it's the right shape too. You don't have to look to the left and to the right too much. Your audience is mostly in front of you. So it's a jolly good conference centre.
No such thing as society, she says. No obligation to the community, no sense of solidarity, no principles of sharing or caring. No such thing as society. No sisterhood, no brotherhood, no neighbourhood, no honouring other people's mothers and fathers, no succoring other people's little children, no such thing as society, no number other than one, no person other than me, no time other than now, no such thing as society, just me and now. That's Margaret Thatcher's society.
Blackpool has a bit of an atmosphere of its own. I mean, it's unashamedly northern. It doesn't give too many concessions to the smart southerners, and it's unashamedly vulgar. I mean, the Spanish Hall in the Winter Garden, where many of the fringe meetings are held, is an unbelievable piece of architecture. I don't know what Prince Charles would think about it, but it provides splendid television shots when you've got some rather dull meeting. Then the conference hall itself has an atmosphere of its own. I think the politicians prefer it because you can hear, I don't know, innovation seems real there, whereas in the modern halls in Brighton and Bournemouth and Harrogate and elsewhere, it's all just a little bit antiseptic. From a journalist's point of view, there are great crannies and nooks where you can gossip with ministers and shadow ministers and things until the chairman starts shouting and telling you to keep quiet. So it's a place for which I've got very many affectionate memories. The weather, of course, in party conferences is usually dreadful, and you're always getting blown and soaked and so on. But apart from that, it's very enjoyable.
In the old days, Formby was Blackpool. His manner, he could walk on stage, and the minute he walked on stage, it was magic, absolute magic. He could hold the audience in the palm of his hand, whether he walked on with or without a ukulele. More often than not, he would walk on stage from the wings, start cracking jokes, and his ukes wouldn't be in his hand. They'd be on a little table at the back of the stage. And, you know, he would come on and crack a few jokes, and immediately that atmosphere, that North Country atmosphere, was there. I'm the president of the George Formby Society. In actual fact, just retired president now with honorary membership. And we've come up to Blackpool, as we do three times a year, to the Imperial Hotel, March, June and September, for our annual general conventions. And of course, September is always the biggest one because we have members all over the world, and they come from all over the world. So I've been a hotel manager for 20-odd years or more, and but unfortunately, just over these last recent years, when you reach my age, you know, it doesn't matter what degrees you have. At 58, it's very, very difficult to get a job because at the moment I'm unemployed. But, you know, looking on the bright side, I always keep hopes and see what might come along. With me little stick of Blackpool rock, along the promenade I stroll. It may get sticky, but I never complain. I like to have a nibble at it now and again. Every day, wherever I stray, the kids all round me flock. A fella took me photograph, it cost 1 and 3. I said, when that is done, is that supposed to be me? You plopped it up, ticked up, the only thing I can see is me little stick of Blackpool rock. You see, it's the whole song is involved around Blackpool. And that's why, of course, the song is so comparative with Blackpool itself.
It's Formby. The most important person in your life?
Oh, has been since I was 7 years of age. I met him when I was 7. His sister took me along to Ealing Studios to meet him, making one of those films. And when I was introduced to him and Beryl, well, you know, to a little kiddie of 7 years old who idolised him, it was really something.
Going to sing a song, and they're going to make a film of it at the same time. So if you see any flashing, don't take any notice, you see. All right, I'm going to sing a song called My Little Stick of Blackpool Rock. This being in Blackpool, we'll have it filmed as well.
Thank you.
Have a teardrop by yours.
Okay.
That was nice.
Monday is chicken. Roast potatoes, seasoning, and veg, whichever the veg of the day is.
Or salad.
If it's chips and salad.
Tuesday is steak and onions and the veggies all with it. And on Wednesday we have lamb, mint sauce and all the roasts with it. Thursday it's pork chops and everything, veggies, seasoning, the whole lot. Friday we do fish and chips because it is a great favourite homemade. You know, if you do it them yourself, we've tried fish with parsley sauce, it doesn't go down. They like ordinary fish and chips with all the salad and everything, and the fruit, ice cream, whatever. Then Saturday, steak and kidney pie. Sunday, traditional roast beef, Yorkshire pud.
Rice pudding.
And homemade rice pudding. No tins.
Dudley House.
Which one was three of them?
27 Cocker Street.
2988.
Empire Hotel.
2342 knots on the prom, State of Lansdowne. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight
I claim
to be able to hold in remembrance, not 5,000, not even 6,000, as many as 10,000 names and telephone numbers. Do we have anyone who can remember more than 5 numbers? Do we have anyone who can remember 10? Ladies and gentlemen, on this list tonight, for you to challenge me, we have as many as 10,000, yes? We have enough to go right round the room. Can we have one over here at the end? Can we have one over here, please?
Barton Garage.
Pardon?
Barton Garage.
The Barton Grange Hotel, ladies and gentlemen. It's got 3 numbers, 2 telephone numbers, one for the reception, one for the payphone, one for the CFAX machine. 861-267, the Telex 67392. Can we have one over here, please?
James Restaurant from
77. 77492. 77472.
That's correct.
77472. Can we have one over here, please? Ladies and gentlemen, we've got the Brighton Guest House. 23317.
That's correct, yeah.
23317. Yes, one at the back.
Yes, sir.
The Highland Welcome.
Highland Welcome. Game of 1457.
Yep.
On the Thursday,
Fiesta Hotel.
Pea green soup. She gave me mashed potatoes. I said, don't you know the difference between pea green soup and mashed potatoes? She said, certainly. Anybody can mash potatoes.
I haven't got a stage name. I've always stuck to my own name, Norman Slater.
What about Dennis? At number 10, comes up to Maggie. He said, it's the Pope and Arthur Scargill. He said, who do you want to see first? She said, I think I'd better see the Pope. I've only got to kiss his hand. Ladies and gentlemen, you've been absolutely wonderful. I mean that, you've been marvellous. But I've got to go. I've got another booking in December, so I've got to get going.
I'm in Blackpool. This is my 31st season. I've actually done at one club. That's called the Philharmonic Club, Blackpool. I've got a good 16 hours of stand-up comedy. I can do, at the Philharmonic, I do an hour a day, and then I do another half hour, like a wheel tapper shunters type thing where I put volunteers on, and I don't repeat a gag for a fortnight. I could actually go a month without repeating a gag. I don't repeat a gag, I don't repeat a song. I also play guitar and sing.
Now, Norman, can you tell me about the tradition of Wakes Weeks in Blackpool?
Yeah, they've been going on a lot of years. Right from the days when the film was on, Hindle Wakes, as you know, that was all to do with the Wakes Weeks, because Wakes Weeks are to do with Lancashire. And their holidays, they call them Wakes. You tell me, I don't know why, but Blackpool usually starts off early on, about May, and they have 2 weeks of old-age pensioners, and all the old-age pensioners come down. And then they start with the Wakes Weeks, which is Oldham Wakes. And for years, comics have cracked jokes about this. When Oldham wakes, Blackpool sleeps, because it used to be about the deadest one. And then they start with all the Bolton, Rochdale, Blackburn, and they're all wakes. Now, the Yorkshire people come down, like Barnsley, and they call it a feast. They call it feast. That's their holiday. And they say, we're coming up Barnsley feast. And they all come down. You've got all your Scottish fortnights. You've got your Glasgow week. You've got your Edinburgh week. You've got your Belfast weeks. on what was Wakes Week.
One of our best mates is gone. Married a woman with worms so he can go fishing.
If there was anywhere in Blackpool that you could play, where would you want to play?
Where would I want to play if anywhere in Blackpool? I think I've always been used to clubs, nightclubs, cabaret spots, there's some wonderful... But I think, obviously, any act of any metal would probably have to... They'd have to plump for the Opera House. It's the biggest... It's got to be the biggest stage and the biggest auditorium in England. Well, not England, Britain. I believe one time it was probably the biggest in Europe. It holds over 3,000 people. And can you imagine, like, I mean, I work clubs maybe with 400 to 600, maybe 700 people in. And the response from them is terrific. So imagine 3,000 people laughing at you or applauding you. What more could you want?
Because the truth of interdependence is this, and let us get it clear. Without the party, the cabinet is powerless. And without the people, the party is powerless. And here's the message. Without the party, the people of this country are powerless to control their destinies in the age of technology.
Well, Blackpool is, apart from being a great leisure centre, it is the Parliament of the North. In the course of the week of our conference, you have these people discussing with great knowledge and experience some of the fundamental questions about the future of society. And I think that to dismiss these as irrelevant and stupid and so on is a mistake, because if you listen very, very carefully, you will find that out of the speeches that are made comes the experience of the people. And socialism didn't come out of a book, and nobody's made a socialist by speech. It's experience. Because although people who come to Labour Party conferences are attacked as extremists and activists and all sorts of other hideous things, they actually are people of immense experience and responsibility, councillors, trade union officials, people who've been active all their lives in this movement or that. And to be picked as a delegate to the Labour Party conference, and maybe true of other conferences too, is an honour comparable to being nominated to be a councillor or a member of parliament. So when all these people gather, you read every day in the paper what a hopeless bunch they are, always fighting each other. Actually, you've got a gathering of quite unrivaled experience.
The policy reviews conducted by senior members of Labour's shadow cabinet will be debated
rule book in Firefax form. It looks smart and modern, and it's loose leaf, and you can slot in amendments as and when convenient.
It's a step forward, because today we reject the nonsensical idea.
Simply say private good, public bad. And then there are those who carry a mirror image and say public good, private bad.
To defy and fell Goliath!
Political editor John Cole reports.
There's a famous seaside place called Blackpool, which is noted for fresh air and fun. And Mr. and Mrs. Ramsbottom went there with young Albert, their son. He, a fine little lad, were young Albert, all dressed in his best, quite a swell, with a stick with an horse's head handle, the finest that Woolworths could sell. They didn't take much to the ocean, the waves, they were spiddling and small. There was no wrecks nor nobody drowned. In fact, nought to laugh at all. So seeking for further amusement, they paid and went into the zoo, where they've lions and tigers and camels, aye, and old ale and sandwiches too. There was one great big lion called Wallace, whose face was all covered with scars, and he lay in a somnolent posture with the side of his face to the bars. Now Albert, who'd heard about lions, how they was ferocious and wild, well, to see Wallace looking so peaceful there, it didn't seem right to the child. So straightway that brave little fellow, not showing a morsel of fear, took a stick with his horse's head handle and poked it in Wallace's ear. You could see that the lion didn't like it, for giving a kind of a roll, he pulled Albert into cage with a eye and swallowed the little lad all.
Blackpool was built for fun, nothing else, and you couldn't have as much fun as in Blackpool's Golden Mile. The Golden Mile evolved in a strange way because peddlers descended upon Blackpool to make money and went onto the beach originally. They sold all sorts of things, patent medicines, foot ointments, everything to Blackpool's visitors. And suddenly the town council decided enough was enough. There were too many peddlers, and they were peddling free of charge. So they brought out a public order that banned them from peddling on the beach. The peddlers did nothing further than look across the road, and they saw some lovely white cottages with forecourts outside, and the origins of the word Golden Mile come out of the rents that the peddlers had to pay to the cottage owners, and so the Golden Mile started.
Anatomy exhibition. Patrons of a sensitive or nervous nature are advised not to visit this section. There is an extra optional charge of 50 pence to this section. This section is totally unsuitable for children.
Now, what would be the perfect bloke that you could meet at the palace? What would he look like?
Got to have a suit on.
Blonde hair.
My ideal one is someone who looks like the Matt of Bros. Blonde hair and the scarf.
Mine's, he's got to have a suit on because it shows that he can afford him. And short hair at the front but long at the back, and it's got to be blonde. And taller than me. Look like people smaller than me.
And a nice big wallet.
Yeah. And a posh car.
Yeah.
That's the main thing we go for, the car.
Posh car.
Yeah.
And if you didn't...
Because I like to be seen in a nice car. It's good, isn't it?
Alan, where's Landon? Now show me.
Right over there. Just under the moon.
When shall we go there?
Whenever you say.
Shall we go tomorrow?
Yes, if you like.
Tomorrow? I can hardly wait.
Jenny, darling, let's not wait for tomorrow. Let's leave now. Tonight.
Tonight?
Yes, why not? We've got a whole week ahead of us. Let's just pack our bags, jump in the car, and leave at once. What do you say, Jenny?
Oh, Alan,
say yes, Jenny. No one need ever know. We'd have a wonderful week. Something we'd always remember.
Very good place for romance, but we never split up. We always went in twos or fours, but it was a good place, yes. There were plenty of friendship, but you see, with us going in a Wakes week, there were nearly all the local boys, so it wasn't much of a change. In fact, I met my husband once on the pier there, and it's not much of a change, is it? There were all the Yorkshire boys and Lancashire boys, and you were looking to get a Yorkshire boy for a change. Well, that was all right. It would be a holiday friendship, and oh, you were going to promise to write. Oh, you were going to write. you did right back twice and then it would fizzle out. Went back to the local ones. And then during the day we'd go on the pier. There was that open air dancing on the pier. You could get a ticket for the day for 6 pence, but if you couldn't afford 6 pence, you'd pay 3 pence, go in the morning at 10 o'clock, you know. And then in the evenings, well, we'd go dancing. We'd think we were like queens because we had a long dress on.
Our perfect evening, though, we go, like, the palace is a big place. There's upstairs and a downstairs. So we might meet a couple of lads upstairs and a couple downstairs, and then we try and go around without the others knowing, like.
Yeah.
We just
get arrange drinks to meet them at, you know, yeah, different times and try to be
give them our telephone, but oh, ring me up and all this.
Have they ever found out?
No.
No.
You've never been caught out?
No,
at all?
Not yet. Suppose we will do one day.
There's something about Blackpool, isn't there, which, right, Blackpool and Bournemouth, they're opposite ends of the English seaside holiday, looking at different markets, but Blackpool reminds me in a way of Las Vegas. Now, that may say an odd thing, but it's got that touch of brassiness about it. Just a touch of, well, vulgarity almost, in a very attractive way. I love the lights. I love the way everything's sort of really harsh and jarring almost in the way it's presented. It's fun, and I think that's what's attracted people to Blackpool over many, many years.
Do you think there's something particularly English about Blackpool or about the characteristics that Blackpool displays?
Well, the seaside holiday of itself is an English phenomena, isn't it? We invented it. The foreigners followed us. And in a way, too, we invented the leisure centre. We invented Disneyland, almost, because that's what the Winter Gardens was. It was designed to be an all-weather complex where you could go and enjoy yourself for a full day. And, of course, it's been the scene of a lot of the great events in the Tory Party conference. Well, of course, it was my first ever platform speech. I think it's fairly well known as Secretary of State for Employment. So that's very much in my mind.
I know those problems. I grew up in the 30s with an unemployed father. He didn't riot. He got on his bike and looked for work, and he kept looking till he found it. There may be some other way, but we have no intention of taking it. I am not willing to throw away the prospects of lasting recovery in an orgy of self-indulgence, forced sentimentality and self-justification, and no one in this government is.
I wanted to go around Britain because I had lived in Britain for 11 years, and I decided that I wanted to write about it, but I couldn't write about Britain without making some kind of gesture, without inventing a trip that would encompass the whole country, the whole kingdom, because I also wanted to include Wales, Scotland, and Northern Ireland. And I needed some form, I needed a trip. And the coastline is a trip. It has a beginning, a middle, and an end. Most of the horror cities in northern England were surrounded by smooth hills and cow pastures and the hopeful contours of green space. And so it was painful to see how Blackpool sprawled along the eastward bulge of Lancashire, displacing the grassy coastline with a 14-mile funfair. From Lytham St. Anne's to Fleetwood, there was no relief. Southport had been modestly elegant. I had called it cluttered, but Blackpool was real clutter. The buildings that were not only ugly, but also foolish and flimsy, The vacationers sitting under a dark sky with their shirts off, sleeping with their mouths open, emitting hog whimpers. They were waiting for the sun to shine, but the forecast was rain for the next 5 months. The Falklands War had entered a new phase. British troops were creeping across the main island, preparing to take Port Stanley. The headlines of the gutter press were Queen lashes Argies, and three British ships hit, and the march towards Stanley. This harsh news certainly coloured my feelings towards Blackpool, because one of the sights of seaside Britain that I knew would stick firmly in my mind was the long promenade and the three piers at Blackpool, the people sleeping in deck chairs, clutching copies of the daily paper, news of the bloody war. They woke snorting and vengeful looking, with pink sleep welts on their cheeks, and then they slapped the papers and went on reading. Tomorrow they'd be using it for wrapping the fish and chips. There was no landscape here. The mass of cheap buildings that had risen up and displaced the land had, in its bellying way, displaced the sea. Blackpool was perfectly reflected in the swollen guts and unhealthful fat of its beer-guzzling visitors, 8 million in the summer, when Lancashire closed to come here and belch. This was northern gusto. This hideous promenade was the golden mile. This bad weather was bracing. But it was just swagger and sandwiches. Bracing was the northern euphemism for stinging cold, and it always justified the sadism in the English seaside taunt, let's get some colour in those cheeks. It was another way of making a freezing wind compensate for the lack of sunshine. And yet not everyone in Blackpool was deceived. Beneath mountainous storm clouds, 17 people on North Pier paid 40 pence each to sit in the sun lounge, a sort of greenhouse on the pier with salt-spattered windows, and listen to Raymond Walbank, your musical host, play I'll Be Seeing You on his console organ until the windows trembled. They sat and listened and read the Daily Mail, 5 RGs die in explosion. And when Raymond Walbank took a breather, they chatted. And once again, I noticed the Falklands news made the English nostalgic about rationing and the Blitz.
When did you start doing Adrian's back?
I don't know.
10 years ago? 15 years ago?
You tell me.
1982.
Yeah.
Are you
sure? Yeah. 1982.
And Adrian, where do you come from?
Me, I come from a little village 80 miles away, Flockton. I've actually been coming to Jimmy's, in the sense coming to Blackpool to see Jimmy, for 17 years. I've never been to any other tattooist. Because if you're going to mark your body, then you surely want your body marking properly. And Jim is the best that I've found. So it's like coming home to me, coming to Blackpool. Wife comes, kids come. Just a day out for us.
And why did you start having tattoos?
That I truthfully can't explain. It's something I always wanted. I suppose, first off, it's the macho thing, you know, the big man because you're tattooed. So I will admit to that. But once you get into a proper tattooist and you talk to the man and listen to the man, or the lady, because there will be ladies that do it, and you get the professional view, like Jimmy always gives, then you look at it in a different light. Then it's not the macho thing, it's a personal thing between me and Jimmy. You know, I'm not bothered if nobody ever sees them, you know, but I know they're there, Jimmy knows they're there, and I know they're as near perfect as they can be done.
So what were the first ones you had done here?
That was the first one. Of course, if you're going to go home to your parents and, you know, get your metaphorical throat cut because you've had a tattoo, then obviously, mum and dad, it takes a little bit of sting out of it. And we progressed on from there, wife, my children. And then just designs that I talked about to Jimmy, and we looked at until we got to the angel carrying a girl towards heaven, in my view. It's like an oil painting, really. The time is taken over it. The work that he's had to put into it is just tremendous. I mean, people just can't believe how much time the man's spent on it.
So, in a sense, you've become blood brothers or something?
Yeah, yeah. I'd walk over broken glass for him. I'd do anything for him, anything. Because he's always treated me right, you know. He ain't just treated me as... You know, you're not just a piece of meat that walks in and walks out and he forgets about you. He cares about his customers. I wouldn't have let a chap do with that that didn't care about me. Coming to Jimmy's now is like going home, you know.
People were never let down because Blackpool was a word. It's in the mind. It's in the memory, perhaps. It's part of oral history. And that when someone went there, they saw what they wanted to see. They felt what they wanted to feel. And that, in a way, it can't fail because it's an invented place. It's part of the imagination. It's part of, perhaps, the northern myth, or what a continuation of all northern myths. And what it looks like to an alien like me, a foreigner, is nothing. I don't see what people see because it's not part of my my folk memory. I've never heard stories about it. The only time I just saw it in films, in those old 60s films where people were having a dirty weekend. But a lot of places are that way. People go to China and they wonder what all the fuss is about. You have to be part of the North, you have to be a Northerner, and you have to have known it perhaps from early childhood to see it, to feel it, and to have some emotional response to it. Otherwise, I think it's a letdown.
Who speaks? Come on, who speaks to me? All right. Give me a moment, all right? When they come in, they're very, very strong, you know. Okay. Don't be alarmed by this. This is merely spirit. This is a way of telling me they're here. This is the lowering of the temperature of the body.
Yes.
There's no way they'll hurt you. Right. They only come to say hello and to guide you.
Okay.
Can I take you back to the age of 19 and a half to 20 and a half? There is indications at that time that you had a romance which was on the cards, which was broken off. Is that correct?
Yes.
And then can I take you forward to 22 and a half to 23 and a half, where there's another new romance which would result in a marriage at about the age...
Absolutely, that's when I got married, indeed.
24 and a half. Well, nothing lasts forever. Do you remember Alan? Say no. It's all
right. No, I can't think. No, I'm just trying to think.
Are you sure?
I can't.
You'd be 35. 35?
36
years old.
I can't think that I know an Alan, in actual fact.
Alan, where's Landon? Now show me.
Right over there. Just under the moon.